Okay, let's get started. We are very excited to have President Rick Levin of Yale University here today, President Emeritus of Yale University here today to speak to us. Before we get started, I'm going to remind you of the fact that you should each one of you should have one of these handouts, which has Rick Levin's biography, short bio on the front, and on the back, it has a space for your name, your section in ESF, and comments and questions that you want to write down. It's very important that you do this and then turn it in to your instructor or your writing instructor, because this is the basis of the discussions that you're going to have in your seminar next week, which will then your seminar will nominate some people to be in next week's plenary discussion about this lecture. So this is the time to prepare for that plenary discussion. Do it today, okay? And definitely hand it in at the end so that find your instructor or writing instructor and make sure that you do that. Okay, I'm just going to do a brief introduction for Rick Levin. So prior to his retirement, which was just this summer, Rick Levin served Yale as president for 20 years. 20 years. I know that most of you are not 20 years old, so he started serving Yale as president before you were born. And I think for many people there, it's very hard to take in the fact that he is no longer president. He is Yale to many people. He's very widely recognized as one of the greatest leaders of American higher education. And here I feel that I don't just need to refer to other people having recognized him that way. I am continually recognizing it myself, whether in conversation with him or reading something he's written. He's just a very insightful person. And in fact, at the end of this talk, I'm going to ask him to read an article of mine and give me comments. That shows you that I really feel that way about it. He's also a very distinguished economist, some of whose most important studies deal with technological change and its role in industry. When Rick Levin took over Yale in 1993, it was not an easy time for the university. The school's buildings were quite decayed. The institution had been running deficits. The city of New Haven was depressed and sometimes dangerous. In fact, my husband, the other Professor Hawksby, and I, he was a graduate student there, and both of us lived in New Haven at the time, and I can testify to the fact that it was not the easiest of times. It was quite a difficult state of affairs for the university and the city. Today, Yale has marvelous buildings, wonderful undergraduate housing, which, as an aside, I will point out is much nicer than yours, fabulous teaching spaces, okay? It is. It just is, okay? It's wonderful. Go there. Visit. It's great. And then complain so that we can get you better housing, too, okay? I'm all for getting you better housing, okay? They have fabulous teaching spaces and great medical and science facilities. Today, Yale is either the or one of the few most financially healthy universities in the world. Today, it's an absolute pleasure to visit downtown New Haven, especially the area surrounding the university, which is filled with lots of nice shops and restaurants and things like that. None of these changes would have occurred without Rick Levin. He led amazingly successful fundraising campaigns, caused Yale to invest billions of dollars in its infrastructure, and helped to revitalize New Haven's economy and the community through a combination of Yale-funded redevelopment, Yale spin-off companies, and student and faculty involvement in New Haven's public schools and social service organizations. So here we have a person who is obviously a great leader and a practical leader, a practical person. But in the spirit of education as self-fashioning, we should take note that the foundation for all of this is Rick's liberal education. He majored in history here at Stanford University, graduating in 1968. So it is his reunion weekend, actually, this weekend. Then he got a second undergraduate degree in politics and philosophy at the University of Oxford. Finally, he earned a PhD in economics from Yale in 1974. That's history, politics, philosophy, economics. He's liberally educated. And conversations at his dinner table must always be rich and broad because his wife, Jane Levin, is the director of Yale's Directed Studies Program, an interdisciplinary program in which students study Western civilization through courses on literature, philosophy, history, and politics. I've always wanted to sit at the Levin's dinner table, just like a fly on the wall. They wouldn't have to feed me or anything. Jane, I feel compelled to mention, was also a Stanford undergraduate, and Jane and Rick Levin met on this very campus. Isn't that sweet? It's nice. You too can aspire to these wonderful things. This is what Stanford can do for you, not just a great education, but great relationships. Internationalizing Yale was one of Rick Levin's great accomplishments. He introduced a policy that provides non-US students at Yale the same financial aid as US students get. He's playing a crucial role in China's efforts to establish world-class universities. And today, one of your readings dealt with how the curriculum of Yale and US, a liberal arts college that Yale started in 2011 in collaboration with the National University of Singapore, was developed. Yale was the first major US university to put its name on an institution of higher education in Asia, and Yale and US is one of the very few liberal arts colleges in Asia. In his final welcoming address to the Yale class, Rick urged students to take full advantage of being in a liberal arts college that is set inside a university committed to path-breaking research. A university like this one, a liberal arts college set inside a research university. He said, this is a quotation, "I encourage you in the strongest terms to take full advantage of the people and resources available here. Don't be shy. The university's faculty, libraries, and museums are here for you. Be adventurous. Do not content yourself with a familiar path. As you choose your courses, try something different, an expository or creative writing class, statistics instead of more calculus, or a new language, even as you pursue further study of one you already know. Sign up for courses and projects that will challenge you. You may never again have so much opportunity to explore new ideas, test out new directions, to pursue different routes to discovering your true passion." I think that is a really important thing to say. You may never have so much opportunity again as you will have in the next 4 years. Stretch yourself. I think that's great advice. And with that, I will stop and Rick will give us
thank you, Carol. That's great. Thank you. Well, that was as generous an introduction as I've ever had. So thank you very much, Carol. I'm quite excited to talk to this group because I think the whole idea of this course is really a terrific one, to be at the time you are beginning to experience what a liberal education might be, to actually reflect on what it could be and what it might mean for you. I guess before I launch into this, I should just clarify the personal anecdote since it seemed to get quite a few snickers. So my wife-to-be, Jane, and I were in the same freshman writing course at Stanford. And I had kind of written about this before. I had a kind of a unique experience. So after the first paper was assigned, it was handed back to all the students, and except the teacher held one paper back in order to read it out loud to the class. And this, for me, was an absolutely shocking experience because I'd never been in a situation where the teacher was reading someone else's paper to the class. So. And it was hers. It was hers. It was really much better than mine. And so I took note of her. Now, we didn't really get to know each other. I had another girlfriend, and she had another boyfriend. I mean, I still had a girlfriend from high school, and she was a freshman dating a senior at Stanford. And so nothing happened freshman year. But then we ended up in Florence, the Stanford program in Florence, in the fall of our sophomore year. And there had been, oh, I should, one intervening fact. In September, it was announced that someone had won the Freshman Achievement Award for the outstanding student in the freshman class. And again, it was not I. So I definitely I had her in my sights and eventually succeeded. And we've had a great life together with our, you know, wide range of interests and many interests in common. Like we learned, she did literature, I did history and politics and economics, and we together took all kinds of art history courses and went to concerts and took music courses. So we picked up that sort of as a common experience. So what I like about this course is most of your sections seem to be reading really great thinkers who have reflected in the past about the meaning of their educations and how education can be a means of forming one's character. You know, whether you're in the section that's doing the Greeks to Augustine, or whether you're in the section doing German intellectuals, or whether you're in the section reading the work of practical leaders like Hadrian and Marcus Aurelius and Jefferson and Booker T. Washington, whichever of the approaches you're taking, I think you can come to the same kind of interesting engagement with, you know, what others have thought through time and history about what education can mean. And it seems to me there, you know, a couple of central themes, and that's what I want to try to address today, really some of the central ideas that I'm sure you'll be thinking about in this course. One question is, what does one need to know? What is in order to function in the world, to achieve personal satisfaction, happiness, and to conduct oneself as a virtuous person, making a contribution as a citizen or a leader? So one question is, what does one need to know? And the second question is, how can education be useful concretely in one's life? So what I'm going to do is try to offer observations on mainly on the first subject, on the first of these questions, what does one need to know? And I'm going to try to do it by talking about the history of liberal education in the United States of America and Singapore at the end. And talk a little bit about both the thinking and the practice of liberal education through American history, because it's really the modern concept. Obviously, these ancient thinkers are dealing with the same issues, but America had kind of its distinctive way of formulating these and making the ideas concrete in terms of a college curriculum. And as I go along, I'm going to also offer some observations on the second question: how does one's education shape and enrich one's life? And I'll try to do that a little bit by drawing in both on history and on some of my own personal experience as a kind of a multidisciplinary student and later a professor and educational leader. So, to address the first question, what does one need to know? I want to talk first about the kind of uniqueness of the American college from the perspective of the content it's offered, that is to say, undergraduate education in America. It is still virtually unique in the world, although things are changing elsewhere in direction of our model, in that the undergraduate program focuses on introducing students to lots of different modes of thinking and ways of thought. Typically in Europe and in Asia, which mostly have in their universities have adopted either a German or a British model, you study one subject. You do your study of multiple subjects in the course of your secondary education in the lycée in France or the gymnasium in Germany. And then you go to the university to study, or as the British say, to read one subject for 3 or 4 years and get a bachelor's degree. This is not what we do here, and it's not what we've done here from inception. That is to say, even in the 17th century when Harvard was founded and in the early 18th century when Yale was founded, the course of instruction looked more, I should say, like a British preparatory school or a French lycée in structure than it looked like the universities in those countries. You studied a range of subjects from the beginning in America. Now, maybe it was because we didn't have very good secondary schools, and it may also have been that students went to college pretty young, younger than today. But But that tradition developed, and as the age of entry raised, was raised over the course of the 18th and early 19th century to what more or less what it is now, that that structure remained in place. Another unique feature of the American undergraduate education is it was very connected to the Protestant religion initially in its foundation. And that had another effect, which is there was a notion of forming character that was really quite explicit. I think it's 12 presidents of Yale were congregational ministers. It was not until 1899 that Yale had a lay person as its president. So almost two full centuries, from 1701 to 1899. Harvard secularized a little earlier than Yale, Harvard was sort of founded in religious reaction, namely, Harvard was not sufficiently orthodox Puritan, and Yale was founded as a reaction against that. Princeton, was founded because, in some ways Yale seemed to have slipped from what the Presbyterians wanted. So it was. There was a lot of religious, there were religious roots in a lot of the foundation of these 19th century colleges, which, slipped away over time, the religious content of it, but the underlying idea that education is about character formation to make an ethical person, I think remained important in thinking about what undergraduate education should be. It's still there. It's not as strong as it was even 50 years ago, but it's still an element. I think. The other thing that America, well, this is true of the whole world, college education was very much available only to the elite. There were, it was in the 19th century, before the Civil War, the percentage of students that went to college was well under 1%. Even at the time of the First World War, dawn of the First World War, after establishment of the state universities, the land-grant colleges that Lincoln introduced, percentage of students going to post-secondary education was only 3% of the population. And even at the end of World War II, it was only 10% of the population. It's since the Second World War that higher education has become more of a norm socially, so that more than half of age cohort today enter higher education, although it's what Carolyn probably knows these numbers, but probably about 30% complete a four-year degree, 30-35%. So in the early years, a kind of coherent formulations of what the object of undergraduate education was were fairly few and far between. I mean, there are lots of talks by presidents of Harvard and Yale. Not many of them are actually focused at trying to truly articulate sort of what it is that students need to know. The first one I came across looking back over the Yale documents was the inaugural address of Ezra Stiles. Ezra Stiles was a great intellectual. He took Yale's presidency in 1778. He was a well-known scholar whose particular passion was the study of Hebrew and Aramaic languages and interpreting the Bible through the original languages in which much of it was written. But he accepted the presidency and gave this inaugural address by actually asking the sort of question of himself. It seems that if one accepts this responsibility, one should explain to the world exactly what it is he knows and what people should know. And so you have this long speech, 30 or 40 pages of text, that essentially is an entire map of human knowledge at the time of Ezra Stiles. It's really quite amazing. When we get to geometry, conic sections are quite valuable for the following reason. I mean, it's really remarkably specific. And he does make, the most impassioned part of it, of course, is making the case for the mandatory study of Hebrew and the hoped for more widespread study of Aramaic. It's fascinating to see this, but it is very much synoptic. I mean, he really is embracing the idea that the undergraduate at Yale at that time And Yale was the largest, at that point, bigger than Harvard, the largest undergraduate institution in the country at that point. That this was, you know, meant to give you an introduction to what humanity knows about physical science and natural science and society and the arts and literature. Quite, and of course, there's a heavy emphasis on classics and Bible study. I'm not sure how much impact that had, but in terms of an articulation that others accepted, but there was a document produced 50 years later, the Yale Reports of 1828, that had remarkable influence, probably the most important statement of what American liberal education is and should be that's ever been written, I think. There's a 19, Harvard's would say that, you know, the 1945 Harvard Red Book is the other document in the same, that has the same classic status. I wouldn't object to that. But the prose in this is much better. I didn't assign it because it's very long and it's a little obscure probably and not as accessible as and I was told it was just wanted limited reading. But it does take on the central question: what should one know? I think very concisely and quite effectively. I'm going to read you just a couple of passages. There actually were three reports: one on the broad concept of the curriculum, one on the specific question of what languages should be studied, and those were prepared by the faculty. The faculties those days were very small, and so the president actually had the pen. And those two reports were given to the Yale Corporation, the governing body, and the corporation gave a response. And so those are the three documents. But now you'll see where the title of this lecture came from. So in the first of these three documents, I'll quote just a sentence or two. The two great points to be gained in intellectual culture are the discipline and the furniture of the mind. The former of these, perhaps, is the more important of the two. A commanding object, therefore, in a collegiate course should be to call into daily and vigorous exercise the faculties of the students. So they're distinguishing here between having a mind that is actively engaged and functions, so we would say today, learning how to think independently is the central part of an education, and then the furniture of the mind are the objects of study. This part is laid out even more clearly at the beginning of part two, where President Day writes, by a liberal education, it is believed, has been generally understood such a course of discipline in the arts and sciences as is best calculated at the time, both to strengthen and enlarge the faculties of mind and furniture, to familiarize it with the leading principles of the great objects of human investigation and knowledge. Then it goes, we've given a little more flesh to that distinction. The furniture of the mind is the leading principles from all of the various areas of study. And then he goes on to make another point about the distinction between liberal education and professional education. A liberal is obviously distinct from a professional education. The former is conversant with those topics, an acquaintance of which is necessary or convenient in any situation in life. The latter, with those that qualify an individual for a particular station, business, or employment. So that's a perfect statement, really, of the distinction we continue to make today, that a liberal education is for forming a whole person, for preparing you in a flexible way to take on any challenge, to a general education that will prepare you for life, whatever your chosen vocation or profession, having that range of content, I'll come to why that's important in a minute, but having that range of content is fundamental, and then of course having a method of training or educating that calls into play your powers to articulate and to debate, to argue, and to formulate independent thoughts. This last piece is articulated particularly well by Cardinal Newman, writing in Britain later in the 19th century, who more or less, I won't say he cribbed the 1828 report, but his writings are, his talk about this is very similar to what the Yale reports said. But he puts a lot of weight on on the meaning of liberal, to equate the idea with freedom of mind, so that a liberal education for Newman is more than just having the discipline of the mind. It's actually having the freedom to formulate an independent opinion, and he puts a lot of weight on the importance of developing the skills of argumentation, formulating an argument, and defending it. And it's very interesting because he says, on the one hand, that the liberal, he emphasizes a short quote, liberal, the free exercise of mind divorced from practical ends. And he really means that, and he gives lots of examples of what that might entail. But then the interesting thing is, toward the end of the idea of the university, he actually tries to defend the notion of liberal education not as an end in itself, but on very utilitarian grounds. That it makes, that if this is the way we educate our students, it will produce good citizens. And that's another strand that you'll pick up in the things you're reading and in the articulation of what liberal education should be today. That you're being formed not just to be successful in your own career, but to be a contributing citizen and to be capable of discerning what arguments best advance the public interest. You certainly find this in Mill and some of the other people that I think you're reading. By the way, yeah, it was interesting. The 1828 reports had one footnote here. 1828 reports were written at a time when there only were 3,500, is that the right number? Yes, 3,600 undergraduate students in all of America. There were 50 colleges that had been open for instruction, and there were just 3,600 students, 9% of them at Yale, which was the largest. Harvard was the second largest with about 7% of the students. There were only 82 degrees, Yale awarded 82 degrees that year, and in all of America, there were just 712 bachelor's degrees awarded. So you get a sense of, when you think about that, it's really impressive that such a powerful articulation of what we were up to in educating in this country was done by so few people, for so few people. It's quite, I think, remarkable. By the way, the report had an enormous impact on shaping the curriculum throughout the United States, partly because, there only were 50 colleges present. Yale was educating 10%, roughly degrees granted, about 12% of the degrees. 18 colleges had been chartered at that point, as of 1828, and opened within the next 5 years. And then many more followed. Most of these were what we think of now as the small liberal arts colleges. About 12 of the 50 initial ones have evolved into state universities. About 10 have evolved into the great private research universities. But the rest, nearly 30, were the Amhersts and the Middleburys of the world, the liberal arts colleges. And these were being founded at this very rapid rate, about half by Yale graduates and about half by Harvard graduates. So and often by very young ones. So what was going on in these schools, it was like a missionary movement, the founding of Midwestern liberal arts colleges and New England liberal arts colleges, it was sort of a colonization by the two leading universities. And they were preaching this mantra that was in the 1828 report. So it's an interesting history. So the bottom line of 19th century thinking, I would say, is that what one needs to know is a lot of central principles of the various modes of academic study and discourse. But even more importantly, one needs to understand how to think independently and how to argue clearly in order to lead both a meaningful life with personal satisfaction and fulfillment, but also an ethical one as a good person and a good citizen. So where do we go from here? In the late 19th century, to my mind, by far the most seminal thinker and actor in the sphere of higher education was a person, alas, who was at Harvard, not Yale, Charles Eliot, president of Harvard from 1869 to 1909. Eliot did essentially established the shape of the modern curriculum. He didn't think that the Yale model, which was then the Harvard model, of having everyone take prescribed courses, everyone take some literature, everyone take the classical languages, everyone take, by then, modern languages, everyone take mathematics, some natural science, some philosophy. He thought that students should be freer, was more aligned with Newman in a certain way, to choose their own subjects. And so while the elective system had been written about by a lot of other thinkers, most famously Francis Wayland, who was the president of Brown, it hadn't been implemented by Wayland. And Eliot implemented it so that students explored from a menu of courses and with, you know, were coached to study the broad range of things. Yale, by the way, didn't move. Yale kept its curriculum fixed for at least a couple of decades beyond Eliot's reforms. But what Eliot also thought was that people should concentrate. So they should get a broad exposure, but at their own pace and of their own choosing, and then they should focus on something. And so Harvard came to introduce what they call concentrations, which is the notion of a major, which didn't exist in America before the 1880s. And this was, this in a way, you know, was more akin to what was going on in Europe, where students studied only one subject, but they got there through what has come to be the general practice of 2 years of this general education, where you get exposure to multi-disciplines and two years of intensive study of one subject. Now, if you think about how we defend liberal education today, I think there are several strands and not entirely consistent necessarily with each other. Like, for one thing, the branches of knowledge which were then seen by Ezra Stiles in the 1828 reports as part of a coherent body of human knowledge have become disciplines, and they're professions for the people who teach those disciplines, and they have their own rules and specific methods of studies and kind of orthodoxies of how things should be studied in each of the disciplines. And so that sets a very different way of thinking about this. I mean, there's still some element of the Stiles rationale for general education. That is, one needs to know about a lot of different things. I'd sort of leave it there. But I'd say there are two more important rationales. One is that the different disciplines give us different tools for solving complex problems. So we think about how do we tackle, and this is where a lot of modern thrust for interdisciplinarity comes. We think about how do we tackle a problem like climate change? Well, we need to know something about the physics and chemistry of the atmosphere. We need to know about the physics and chemistry of the ocean. We need to know about what the effects of temperature on agriculture, about the effects of sea level rise on coastal settlement. We need to understand what would happen if populations migrate from coast to inland. And so that brings into play some of the social sciences and demographics. We need to understand the economic consequences of climate change and what it does to the productive activity. And then, of course, the health effects. How will it affect human health? So it's a problem that each of the disciplines gives us a set of insights that helps us comprehend the whole. And you can say that about pretty much any of the important societal problems today, eradicating poverty. Has, you know, a physical health component, a social component, an economic component. It can be studied from many, and a spiritual one, I suppose, as well. And they can be studied from many perspectives. So that's one sort of rationale for why it's good to know something about a lot of disciplines. There's another one, which is the one I have actually favored in a lot of things I've written, which is, and it reflects this is what reflects my own personal experience of having studied multiple disciplines in a fairly, you know, in more than a superficial way. And that's it. I think you can think of the different disciplines as giving us a different method of interpreting or constructing reality, and, you know, of understanding the world, and that our understanding of the world is enriched by looking at it from these multiple perspectives. So literature and history are similar in the following way. They both require the reader to transport him or herself to some other time or place or to some imagined world. And the capacity to enter into the perspective of the other, to me, is a really fundamental part of human experience. How are you going to have a relationship with a significant other unless you can actually learn how to think, where is she coming from? You know, what values is this person bringing to the table and offering to me? How does that person construct the world in a different way than I? It's particularly acute when you encounter people from different cultural backgrounds, different nationalities. And that's one of the reasons that I have been such a strong advocate for international experiences for Yale students. Because once you go to a different country, I mean, it's easy to stereotype, but I'm not talking about the sort of superficial stereotype. It is generally true, despite the fact it can be easily stereotyped, that people in different countries actually, and working through different languages, actually do construct the world somewhat differently than we do. And they may share different notions about values. They may have a different view of the relative importance of the individual and the community. I think that's actually really true if you think about Americans and Asians and certain other cultures where the focus on the individual is really extreme, I think, in American culture. So some of the disciplines really help us understand that that question of how to get inside someone else's head, or another way of saying it, to develop the capacity for empathy in understanding other human beings. In my own personal education, I spent, you couldn't find courses on this very much, but I spent a huge amount of my time, freshman and sophomore years, reading essentially all of Freud. Because I found that a tremendously insightful, it's very old fashioned now, it's not the medical doctors that study psychiatry think it's all sort of worthless. But I saw it, it's a kind of philosophy of the person, and I found it to have extremely useful insights. I will tell you that without the concept of the unconscious, without the understanding that people often say things that have a much deeper meaning than what it would appear on the surface, sometimes they say the opposite of what they mean. Sometimes they say what they really deeply mean, and without realizing that's what they really deeply mean. This is, I don't know, all that kind of insight, which was incredibly valuable to someone who was, you know, chairing an economics department, subsequently leading a university, having to deal with people coming asking for stuff all the time. What is this person really saying to me? You know, I hear the words. What's underneath it? You know, what can I figure that out? And for me, psychology of the unconscious was an incredibly valuable tool. Clear expression is extremely important in life. And so the disciplines that really teach that robustly, like philosophy, which really force you rigorously to frame an argument and defend it rigorously and leave no holes in it, that was an incredible training for me. And it has been just an extremely valuable tool to be a clear, lucid, you know, writer who is very, very conscious of what is saying and what words are doing, for one. So just a few examples. I mean, and obviously the sciences give us a way of understanding, you know, the our place in the universe and how life works, and also give us, important metaphors for particularly biology, important metaphors for interpreting experience. Now, there are, so that's some of the reasons why it's still valuable, I think,
to learn multiple disciplines. Today, there are a couple of critiques of liberal education. I'll just mention two. There's one that kind of the curriculum is very biased. It's the product of the dominant class at whatever time the curriculum's developed, that it tends to be biased against the underprivileged of all kinds, and that it's fundamental to sort of make sure that all voices are heard in the discussion. And I at one level, it's really hard to argue against that. It's a fair insight that we need to hear multiple voices. But it's also important not to go too far in the direction of canonizing ideas that actually really don't hold up to critical scrutiny. I mean, ideas are no more right because they reflect the views of the oppressed than they are right because they reflect the views of the dominant. So, I think for me, the key is scanning widely and make sure the curriculum covers a wide range of views, but also be open-minded and be subject to everything to critical scrutiny. There should be no orthodoxies in the academy. Everything should be up for grabs. There's a wonderful quote from Thomas Jefferson. I think I may use it in one of the pieces you read. He wrote a letter to his nephew and it said, fix reason firmly in her seat and call to her oracle every fact, every opinion. So take nothing for granted. So look for the deepest truths. The second critique of liberal education, it comes more from outside the academy. The first one really comes from inside. This is a loud voice today, is that liberal education doesn't prepare you for careers. And it's that our undergraduate programs today are insufficiently vocational, and that we are losing out to other countries that practice more specialized and more vocationally oriented training. The easy answer my colleagues use often is kind of reflexive, even though largely true, seems somewhat defensive. The idea that broader education makes us better at whatever we do, and the other point that, well, the system is, actually the American system has a complex structure. There are lots of layers of higher education, and the elite universities, it's true, focus on liberal education and the preparation is very non-vocational. But when you get down to the community colleges and some of the state colleges, there's a lot more opportunity to pick up vocational training as part of an undergraduate program. These are right, I think. I mean, these are not wrong answers, but they are a little facile in a certain way. And you should think about this. I'd love to hear your reactions. I mean, I've come to think lately that we're not doing some of our students a great service by not helping them a little more in the context of this vast menu of options that they get, to give them a little more structure so that if they choose to major in art history or philosophy or music or English literature, that they are sort of channeled in the direction of, just to make sure you can get a job when you graduate, maybe you should also take a statistics course, an economics course, and enough courses in writing that you can express yourself and speak clearly. I'm not trying to hold out anything special about my own discipline of economics, but I do think I've seen enough students who get panicked around their senior year and in the year that follows. Because they may have done extremely well in the humanities, and they feel they can't get a job. What I worry about happening at Stanford is too few stick it out. I mean, at Yale, we still have over 30% of the students majoring in the humanities, and here it's down to almost single digits, and that's I think that's unfortunate. So people who are in this course are probably somewhat inclined toward the humanities. I would say stick with it, but just you know, get enough tools, take a computer programming course, take a stats course, take microeconomics, so at least you can, you know, if when you finish, you think, okay, now I need a job for a few years, and then maybe I'll come back and go to the law school, go back and go to graduate school in the liberal arts. You have the option. You know, you have better employment prospects, but I think it's an issue for the future. The people who favor this more intense vocational preparation often look at Asia, and they say, wow, these people are going to eat our lunch competitively because they're training vast numbers of engineers in India and China, way, way more than we are, and they're going to dominate the world economy in the future. Well, here's an irony. If you go to Asia and talk to leaders there, to the government leaders and to business leaders, what you find is we have too many engineers. And what we don't have is what we don't have is Silicon Valley. What we don't have is a lot of creative entrepreneurship. We don't have innovation. All the innovation, all the new products, all the new ideas come from America. And, you know, we're good at executing. And we now are even part of the value chain in those innovative industries. But who are going to be the leaders in Asia who are going to be the creative, independent thinkers who come up with the new product ideas and don't just imitate what's happening elsewhere? And so what you see in the Chinese government and the Ministry of Education is, for example, a real, genuine interest in how do we change our undergraduate curriculum at our top universities, not throughout this massive system, but at the top 10, or actually the group of 9 top universities, so that we have a better shot at producing the kind of people who drop out of American universities. but a lot of the ones who finish, too. Actually, I've personally been very involved in this because since 2005, I've run an annual seminar with the presidents and some of the key academic vice presidents, and an unusual job they have there. Every organization in China has a president or a leader, but also a party secretary, a member of the Communist Party, who kind of minds the store. And so all these people have been coming to Yale, or we've been going there every summer for a week or two to talk about educational reform. And the thing that they're most interested in is one, how do we restructure the curriculum to give students more general preparation so they have a multidisciplinary perspective? And most of them have already started to do that. So within the last 7 or 8 years, many of the top Chinese universities have a curricular structure that looks much more like America. You don't necessarily have to pick a subject before you enter. You can take general education courses in at least the first year, and then you pick a specialty. And the other thing they're really interested in is the kind of interactive pedagogy that we practice, where students are actually forced to speak up and to defend themselves in small group seminars and learn the skills of argumentation and not just recite back what the professor said. This is an intense interest in China. It's spread throughout Southeast Asia. Koreans are very interested in changing their system too. The Indians actually are not at this disadvantage because the British legacy there is so strong that while they have specialized education, they have a lot more interactivity. The pedagogy is a little more like ours. But this is a really interesting development, and just this will get me to the sort of the end, and we take some questions. But it was this interest in Asia in liberal education that got us inspired at Yale in partnering with Singapore, the government of Singapore and the National University of Singapore, to create a new liberal arts institution that was really specifically designed for global citizenship. It brought many of the features of American liberal education to Asia, but very much in partnership, a co-design to create a kind of education that would be practical and useful in an Asian context. We chose Singapore rather than China, which was also urging us to do something like this, because we felt that even though there's, from our point of view, an unacceptably high level of suppression of free expression in the political sphere, it was nothing like China. I mean, China's much worse, and the internet's censored. I mean, Singapore, the internet's not censored. I mean, it's a lot more open, although there are these strong libel laws that are not something that we like very much. But we did have the Singapore government's assent to sort of making our campus kind of an oasis so that anything goes, anything can be said or challenged on the campus, if not in the public square. And so we were able, and you read some excerpts from the report, we've been able to design a kind of radically new curriculum that's old-fashioned in one way, in that it has 12 courses that everyone takes in common, but quite new in another, in that it's really attempting to put the history of thought in the Asian traditions and in the Western tradition in juxtaposition, so that they can be read together and people can think about what that implies for getting different perspectives on the world. There's also a couple of throwback ideas. I mean, there's a real focus on articulate communication, lots more deliberate focus on making students give oral presentations in class and defend themselves orally, sort of a throwback to the old days of teaching rhetoric in the 19th century. And there's also a lot of focus on explicitly on the question of character formation. So we're very excited about this, and I don't know that some of that enthusiasm, I think, comes through in the document that was authored by a committee, but primarily by Brian Garston, a really thoughtful Yale professor who's taken a big role in helping to shape that curriculum. So I think that pretty much wraps up what I wanted to talk about. I think I've covered some of the current debates and arguments. Talked a little bit about Singapore, and I'm happy to, you know, use the rest of the time to answer questions about any aspects of this, or frankly, anything you'd like to hear about that a university president might know. Maybe. Thank you. Yes. So the schools that really practice the kind of high-level liberal education, which is, as comprehensive as we've been talking about, and also has enough small class interaction, you know, has faculty-student ratios that give students a real opportunity to engage directly with each other and with faculty. Those schools, I mean, putting on an education like that is very expensive, and it's. Depending on the institution you're in, also actually costs to deliver much more than the full tuition. So schools like Stanford and Harvard and Yale and Princeton and many other of the top 25 or 30 or 40 schools are heavily subsidized by past gifts to endowment that support a lot of the cost of undergraduate education. So at Yale, we estimate, even though we're charging, you know, $56,000 for tuition, room, and board to the people that pay full price, that it actually costs us more than $100,000 a student per year to actually deliver what we deliver. And it's a, you know, like here, it's a pretty rich set of resources that you have available to you, great library, fabulous facilities, and, you know, great labs, all kinds of things that are part of it. So the cost is high. The cost has risen faster than general inflation for a reason that has a simple logic, but it's not always grasped so easily by people. And that is, if you think about most other industries, there's changes in technology that actually allow you to get more output for a given physical input. So today, for the same amount of silicon, you could get a lot more memory on a computer chip because of technical progress. But if you want the experience of a small class, you can't multiply the amount of students you have by a professor at 5% a year, per professor at 5% a year, and still have the same experience. So If you want a class of 18 or 15, it's kind of a fixed proportion of output, student learning, and input, the faculty member who you have to pay, doesn't change. So that, you know, unless you kept the wages of that faculty member from rising so that they fell forever, fell asymptotically to zero, you would not be able to keep the price you charge for the education at the level of inflation. It tends to exceed it. Now, we've exacerbated the problem in this country in the last decade, especially by under support of the state colleges and universities in our system. So while you see increasing published prices for tuition, room, and board in the private sector schools, you see a rate of growth that's more than double. I think the private sector rate of growth of tuition in the last decade is about 2.5% higher than inflation, 2.3% higher than inflation. In the private side, you know, 4.5%, 5.7% actually, if I remember correctly. And it's even worse if you factor in financial aid, because the schools like Yale, Stanford, Harvard, and Princeton have actually offset the rise in tuition for the neediest students, so that students with incomes below the median in the U.S. have actually seen, actually pay nothing for parent contribution, and the average price being paid by a student today in those top schools is actually flat over the last 10 years. Hasn't gone up. The price to those who pay full tuition has gone up by a few percent. So it's a problem, it's a particularly severe problem in an era where government funding for any kind of discretionary expenses are being really threatened and challenged. Another whole story, largely by rising healthcare costs, but that's a whole different talk. Yeah. So that's a good question, and I think the question is at what level, at what time of life is it most valuable to actually get this exposure to multiple subjects? And I guess I would argue personally that I think the American model kind of has it right in that we're taking students at at age 18 to 20, when they've achieved already a high level, you know, pretty high level of foundation. And they're also at a stage of life when they're starting to think about, I'm becoming an adult person. How do I want to shape my life? I think the average 19-year-old thinks about that more than the average 16-year-old. And maybe that's just because they're in college. But I think that's, at least in our society, it kind of makes sense to put that period of questioning, of probing, of testing. What am I really interested in? Where is my passion? What subjects do I want to pursue in more depth? You know, so let's get that exposure to that broad menu in those key formative years. It worked. I mean, you know, it'd be nice to, you know, maybe Caroline will run the controlled experiment that actually tests out the time of life at which you take this on. But the trouble is, you would have to study the results looking back, you know, from 10 years after graduation or so, to really get a meaningful answer to the question, I think. Yeah.
So I know that, like, there's, like, a growing movement among, like, community colleges and, like, just, like, people looking to get a job. So how do you sell the general public on the idea of a liberal education, like, if they're not participating in a university?
Well, you know, I actually don't think this kind of education really is for everyone. I mean, it really is, I think, works best for people with a pretty high level of achievement and a high level of capacity. I don't think we're reaching all of the students of that type. I mean, Professor Hauksbee's work is actually the paradigm of proving that that's the case, that she's done some terrific work showing that we're only hitting a small fraction of the high-achieving, low-income students in our society and getting them into the highly selective schools. That's an important social problem to solve. But I think for most people in the community colleges, they're probably correctly placed. That is, they have kind of medium median performance in high school or lower, and probably the most valuable thing they could do is develop some vocational skills that help that render them productive citizens. So I think the idea of having a kind of differentiated system where people can sort by ability and potential is a good thing, actually, in America. I mean, the alternative is just not to give them any higher education at all, which is what most countries in the world do. And that's not great. Yeah. I'm missing.
Some people get a liberal education, but others get more professional education. There's sort of a division in society between those two groups of people. So, like, they don't share as much of a cultural background, cultural, social.
Well, that is a problem. Some of this foundational work is, of course, should be done in the secondary schools. That is basic exposure to history, some fundamental exposure to science, writing skills, arithmetic, are shared by, theoretically, by everybody. And I think that's probably the best answer. Does it create, I mean, when we say professional, I think vocational is the right word for undergraduates, because professional we think of as postgraduate training of people that are liberally educated to go further in medicine or law or business or, you know, some of the professions. Yes?
Do you think that there is a certain sense of being able to use the precepts taught under liberal education as simply a private citizen or like living your own life rather than actively trying to go out and change things in a big way? Is there some value to that?
Absolutely. And you know, one of the things to work on is get away from thinking there are precepts taught, because I think what we're trying to do is, you know, expose you to lots of different ideas from different thinkers of the past and present, and you figure out, you know, what are the values that you will live by. But that to me is incredibly important. I mean, so it's the self-formation, which is self-fashioning, I guess you call it, is a fundamental, you know, core of this course. And of course it's meaningful that one should try to develop a kind of integrated conception of, you know, what kind of person am I, and what kind of values do I live by, and what kind of passions do I have that I'm going to pursue, whether they be in my citizenship or in my career or just in my personal life. I mentioned earlier getting an exposure to art history and music as an undergraduate, which I didn't have, I knew popular music, but I had very little knowledge of or interest in the fine arts until I got to college, and it just opened up a world for me that's not professional, but it's just, now it's something I have a lot of interest in and a lot of passion for and spend a lot of time, going to museums and concerts to enjoy. And it's an enriching, kind of spiritually enriching part of one's life. So yeah, I think those things are, you know, equally important as the more practical, outcomes-focused thing. Yeah?
What specific subjects would you include in your ideal liberal education curriculum?
What would I include?
What specific subjects, yeah.
Well, I think that we had a chance to build one, so I think you can look at this Singapore curriculum and that's pretty close. I mean, the first year curriculum, it has essentially four tracks. One is literature and the arts. One is philosophy and politics. One is social science, essentially, but it's not taught like social. It's called comparative social institutions, that uses the perspectives of different social science disciplines. And the last one is natural science, which the first course of which is kind of foundations, scientific method. What constitutes scientific knowledge? How is it developed and how is it tested? And then we do stream after that to people who want to go on in science, to people who just want a basic exposure to the different subject areas. But that's the sort of core at Yale NUS. And I was pretty intimately involved in helping the faculty work this out, so I think that's a, I like it. And then there's some other common courses that students take later on. And these are kind of innovative. One is a historical immersion course, because in you're reading in these other courses, you're not really learning history. You're learning the history of ideas more than history in the first two. So the idea is pick a period, pick a year, 1492, 1789, and do a deep dive into understanding what was going on in that particular time and place that you're studying. Another one of these common courses is a kind of I'm forgetting that. Pick a contemporary social problem, and then attack it from the perspectives of the various disciplines that play on it. And then everybody participates in a senior capstone where they have a research project and report on their research results to everyone else. So it's across disciplines. So the students who are doing a literature topic will actually come once a week, and as these people are developing ideas, they'll talk to one another about the English major will talk to the philosophy major and to the physics major about what they're doing. This was based on something we have at Yale called the Mellon Forums, which are for seniors to present their senior research, and it works really well. Good Lord, that's good. I like the interaction. It's way back. The two of you with your hands up, one after the other. Well, the world today is very much a product of multiple faiths and many people with no faith. And I think that I believe we're past the time where an institution with the aspirations that Yale has to be a major player in the world of education and research, we're long past the time when it would make sense to embed Christianity, the study of Christianity, into everyone's study. I mean, courses, we have wonderful courses. We have a great religious studies department, actually, and some wonderful introductory courses that deal with comparative religions, and of course many specific courses that go into great depth in one or another religious tradition. That's all available. We have no common core at Yale, just as you don't have no common core at Stanford. So it's not a required subject. In Singapore, it will be a subject that is deeply enmeshed in both the literature course and the philosophy course, because many of the texts that will be read will be the products of religious thought. Some of the early Asian epics are deeply connected to Hindu or Buddhist tradition, and some of the and of course Dante and Inferno and Paradise Lost are deeply embedded in the Christian tradition. So I think there'll be exposure to religious thinking and religious perspectives on the world, but also to Enlightenment and post-Enlightenment thinkers who don't incorporate that perspective. Yeah, and next to you. It's a very good question, I think. Education, before the communications revolution of the past few decades, I think that educational systems were in pretty significant isolation from one another. I mean, we know a lot more, there's a lot more familiarity, I think, with what other people do than there was, you know, when I was a Stanford undergraduate. And I think they I think systems tend to develop and then embed themselves into the culture and traditions of the society in ways that are hard to change. And so it's true that Asia basically, you know, they didn't have universities in Asia. They had ancient universities in India, but they didn't, in the modern period, they didn't have them. And so then the late 19th and early 20th century, countries like India and China set up a bunch of universities on basically that were colonially influenced. So they basically were adopting European models. It is a good question. Why haven't European countries tended to look at the U.S.? And what they would mainly say, I think they do in secondary school what we do in the first 2 years of college. It would probably be the answer, at least for their elites. And at a certain level, they may be right in that they do have more ambitious curricula at the high end of their secondary school system than we do. But, you know, they read more of these classical works and that sort of thing. So and I guess the question is, are people really getting them in the same way they get them as a couple of years later? It goes back to the question that was asked earlier. Yeah, way back there. Well, there will be catch up, and it means probably higher incomes and more and better standards of living for the whole world, and that's not a bad thing. On the other hand, I think it is very important that we continue to invest in being at the frontier of science and technology. We have been there through the entire period since the Second World War, and largely as a result of a pretty far-sighted consensus on the importance of doing that. And in structuring it in a way that gives a lot of autonomy for the scientific community to direct funds in the direction of the most promising substantive research outcomes. So, we have a good system. Right now, the biggest threat is just because of all this, you know, sort of paralysis in Washington about that there's been a tendency to starve the funding, not grow at the rate of the economy as a whole. So, for example, research support by the federal government, the federal government's budget, 10.5% of the federal government's total expenditures in 1963 went to R&D, and today, to research and development. Today, it's 3.5%, so it's been kind of crowded out, and it's fallen from nearly 2% of GDP, publicly funded research, from 2% of GDP to less than 1% over the same 50-year period. So this is problematic, and I've argued in many forms that this is something we need to turn around, actually, to sustain our lead. I mean, the other way in which we completely shoot ourselves in the foot is by restricting immigration of high-performing, high-achieving graduates of American universities. So we train a lot of foreign talent, and only a limited number are allowed to stay behind because of quotas on the requisite visas. And this seems to me is very foolish because, you know, that talent could be working here and you know, helping to strengthen America's economic edge. So this is one of the crusades I've engaged in is what I termed about a decade ago, Tom Friedman picked up, called stapling a green card to the diploma. I think that would be a good idea.
We have time for just two more questions.
Oh, how to choose. I was about to call on the person in the way back row. We'll do that one. Yeah.
Commonly in a liberal arts education, we talk about social sciences and curious about what you think about the importance of, because the theory of liberal arts education is supposed to free the person. So I think having a discernible skill or having something that you can build with your hands is also a very important aspect of liberal arts education, but commonly we don't care about that. For example, in computer programming, we tend to criticize that so many people are in computer science. However, in computer science, you also learn how to think like a machine and think logically and do all these other things. So I'm curious about why there's such an emphasis on one side, yet we don't tend to think about the other side as well.
I'm with you. Liberal education embraces the sciences. I mean, it's not like, sometimes the word liberal arts is used to mean, like you said, social science and humanities as opposed to sciences. In all of our rhetoric about Yale and US, we talk about liberal arts and sciences, just to be clear that the conception means the whole span of human knowledge. And I totally agree with you about learning skills like computer programming. That was part of what I was trying to say, that even those of you who major in the humanities, I mean, a first course in programming is a really valuable thing to do. A course in statistics is a really valuable thing to do. I think it develops things that a functioning citizen needs, and it also, you know, helps with employment in many standard kinds of jobs. So, yeah, I would completely embrace that. Not everybody needs to be a computer scientist, but everybody should know a little something about machine logic and how it works. Yes, we'll take you as the last one, right there.
So many of our government leaders have degrees. Top colleges, a lot of them, Stanford claims them, Harvard, Yale, Princeton, yet our government has been almost shut down for decades. Our debt is astronomical. The NSA is spying on us. Our civil liberties are being crushed every day. Has liberal education failed our government, or is it below politics?
Well, that's a great question. You know, who gets blamed for the failure of America, of government in America and the problems of government in America? I think there's a lot of blame to go around, right? And I don't know that I'd put it all on the colleges and universities. Parents, the media, and then there's a lot of just simple structural things wrong with our political system, I think. That make our government less responsive to what the common sense, popular view of things is. I mean, we the polarization. Most people in America don't want the government shut down. They don't want to see this polarization. They're much closer to the middle than the people in Washington, and part of that's the structure of a two-party system with closed primaries, gerrymandered districts. Special interests being able to buy a lot of, buy congresspeople. There are a number of electoral reforms that, if we could get the will to do it, would actually, I think, make a difference in making the system more responsive. And you look at so many of these issues that are contentious, and it's actually a small minority of people who actually support them. I mean, the people who are avid about lower taxes or smaller government, it's a quarter of the population. The people who don't think we should have abortion is a quarter of the population. The people that think there's no climate change is a quarter of the population. And yet those views are basically, if not prevailing, they're deadlocking. They're making the action impossible. So, yeah, I think we could do a lot to make our democracy function better. And yes, universities should shoulder some of that burden and I don't want to turn around and blame it on Washington. We could do a better job of educating in those subjects. Thanks. You've been a terrific audience. Thank you.
And I'm glad you gave your club a good thanks. Don't forget to hand your sheet into your instructor or whatever.